A while ago, I published a video on a free piece of software called Sequator or Sequator. And in the comments section of that video, a fellow called Dummy Joe, that's his handle on YouTube, not my particular name for him, asked me a question. He wanted to know if Sequator could be used for processing star trails. And the answer is a most definite yes. So this video is going to be a short intro to how to process star trails in Sequator or Sequator. And the subsequent videos will take that image further into Photoshop and to the finished image. Hi, my name is Will, and if you haven't bumped into me or this channel before, I photograph African nature. So for me, that means wildlife, birdlife, landscapes, and astrophotography. I typically make vlogs out in the field, I bring those images back home here, and I post-process them for you. So if that kind of content excites you, hit the subscribe button, and in the meantime, let's get into this video. In this video, we're going to take a series of 45 images of the night sky shot in the Richtersveld in South Africa, one of the darkest parts of the planet. And we're going to stack each image on top of the other one using a free piece of software called Sequator to produce a star trail like this one. And you can make this process very simple or you can make it more complicated. In this video, we're going to keep it simple, but I am going to use a tool that I also have called Topaz Denoise AI. Now, if you haven't heard of that tool, you can get a 30-day free trial down below. And if you don't want to use it, you can just skip this step in the video, but it does produce much cleaner images if you do it this way. The very first thing that I want to do here is go into the develop module in Lightroom and just check that there's no presets and camera profiles applied to these pictures. The reason for that is twofold. First, I don't want any noise or sharpening applied to the image before I take it into Topaz Denoise, because that piece of software is going to do that for me. And second off, I don't want any camera profiles applied when I take these images into Sequator, because sometimes they can cause pattern noise and artifacts in the image. I want a clean file. Now, if you're trying to save space or you're using a slower computer, you should export as JPEGs, but I'm going to export as TIFF files. So that's a raw format that's going to contain all of the data that I need later on for post-processing. So if I run down the basic panel in this image that I've got open here on the right-hand side of the screen, I'm just checking to see that there's no changes made to the photograph, and particularly that there's no sharpening or luminance applied. Then I'm going to come up to the library module, make sure that all of my 45 images are selected, and I'm going to go File, Export, and I've created a preset. It's a TIFF format, and it's just going to save those into a folder ready for me to use. So if I come down and press export here, all of those files will be exported into a folder. And like all good cooking shows, here is the folder that I made earlier. So I'm going to take these images into Topaz Denoise, and all I need to do that is to drag them into the screen. So Denoise is going to open those up, and fantastically, it allows for batch processing of images. You can see those on the screen here. Now, this is not a Denoise tutorial. I have another tutorial for that, which I'll link to. It's about bird photography, but the same things apply here. So I'm not going to do it right now. It's enough to know that this is how we clean up the images. Once I've got those files out of Denoise AI and into an output folder, I can pull them into Sequator. So I open up the application, and up at the top left here is an item called Star Images. It's got a little red light next to it. If I double click on that and open up the location where I've saved the images, I can highlight them all and just click Open. And here I've got a little green light next to where it says Star Images. The next item down on this menu is the base image. Now, for star trails, we want to choose the first image in the bunch, whereas for aligning stars, we need to choose the middle image. And you can see that in my previous tutorial. So here I'm going to double click it again. I'm going to choose the very first image as my base image. Now, in my case, I don't have any noise images. These are typically things called dark frames, and they're a rather obscure term for something very simple. All it means is a series of images typically taken at the end of your shoot with exactly the same settings as you use to take the star images, the only exception being you place the lens cap on the camera before you took the image. And the idea here is to identify the hot pixels on your sensor. In this instance, I don't have any dark frames, so I can just move right along and ignore it. The final traffic light here is marked output. If I double click it, I just need to choose a file name for this, and I'm going to call it Star Trail, rather originally, and click save. And now you can see the traffic light next to output has also turned green. The next step is to move down into the composition area and choose some of the options down here. Now, I don't want to align stars, so the first item I'm going to double click on is going to change it from align stars to trails, and that's changed the menu items. If you want to see how to align stars, that's in the previous tutorial. So here I have very few things that I need to do because all of these images were shot in the same location on a tripod with the same settings on the same night. That's very important for star trail photography. And because I've done that, it's a very simple process to process these images. A lot of these items in the bottom left panel on Sequator are for where we've shot images on different nights or with different settings to try and resolve those problems, or perhaps where there's a lot of night pollution or light pollution. I don't have that in this instance because it's a very dark area, and that makes things extremely simple for me. So the only thing I'm going to do is check remove dynamic noises. And the reason I want to do that is because I have none of those dark frames that I talked about earlier. And what this is going to do is trying to remove those hot pixels, particularly in the dark area of these cliffs, and it's going to remove those hot pixels and make the image much cleaner. Remember, Topaz Denoise also did that for these sequence of pictures. Finally, the last thing I'm going to do is right-click where it says Color Space because I want to process this image further in Photoshop, and I'm going to choose Adobe RGB. The rest of these options, it's quite easy to just go onto the Sequator manual, which I've linked down below, and read through them. But also there's tooltips. If you click on each of them, you can check what they actually do to your image. The only other one that I would like to mention is the sky region and producing a mask to mask out the foreground. That might be very important to you. So I'm going to choose an irregular mask. And the great thing about Sequator is it doesn't need to have a lot of detail in that selection. And I'm also going to choose something called auxiliary highlight because that's going to indicate exactly where that mask is being applied. Once I've done that, clicked on sky region full area and then choose sky region irregular mask, I get a little icon coming up on my screen indicating a brush. And I can left click on there and I can draw on the screen. The minute I do that, you'll see, because I've got auxiliary highlights selected, all of the stars are red, and also the horizon line is red. So this mask is going to be applied to that area as it stands. So to increase the size of my brush, I can use the scroll wheel on the mouse, and I'm just going to paint in this sky with this rather snazzy shade of green. And the wonderful thing about this software is I really don't need to be that accurate. I just need to dodge the cliffs and the hills in this shot. And you can see with the irregular highlight turned on that it's done a fairly good job of highlighting the stars in this image. We are ready to hit the start button and actually process this image. One of my favorite things about photographing stars and the night sky is how many different ways there are to approach the subject. You saw in this video that I used 45 shots. You don't have to do that for star trails. You can go old school and shoot them in one go. Now, I'd really like to hear from you. What's your favorite way of processing star trails? What's your favorite piece of software? And what settings do you use? Let's hear in the comments below, because I think that information will be so useful for other people coming to this video.